So now we know a few things. Luke uses 112 here for the Bar Kokhba aftermath, which ties to the same phrase that the Lord is actually using for the period of 190 to 199 AD. Luke moves it up here to Bar Kokhba. The effect of Bar Kokhba was to get the Bible out, to get people out of Jerusalem so that they would be in diaspora, take their Bibles with them, whether they were Jew or Gentile, whether they were Christian or Jewish. So now we know something really important about the theme of this passage. You would know it without knowing Luke, just by looking up the history of the items that are marked in what we'll call gold, orange, right here. These numbers all have very specific meanings in the Bible, both in the text and in the meter especially. So you would know something of what these numbers mean just because of that. Alright, like 49 is the dateline that Daniel 9 uses for the rebuilding of the temple. So 49 comes to mean diaspora. It also comes to mean petition to rebuild. The whole purpose of the temple was so that people could have a place to move with their feet to vote to know God. Okay? And so Matthew uses it here because he's padding. He's not talking about Christ's own words yet. He's using it here just before Christ says the first words that he's saying in the passage. Matthew's saying, "Hi, I'm writing you 49 years after Herod's temple started to be rebuilt." Well, the topic is the temple, so it's not too hard to understand. The topic is the temple. And Herod started rebuilding it officially in 19 BC. So Luke is writing in 30 AD, which is what, Matthew's writing in 30 AD, which is also what Matthew 1's dateline is. And more, the way Matthew dates it in Matthew 1 is a lot more definitive. But, you know, it's not hard to know this because every Jew would know when Herod started rebuilding the temple. You'll notice, since this is prophetical, 40 years after Christ speaks, and we know when he speaks because of this, the temple will be down, which of course it will. That'll be 70 AD. So this is something of an anticlimactic asterisk. Hi, I'm writing you 49 years after the temple started to be rebuilt, and it's going to go down 40 years from now. Ha ha. This sort of equidistance punning is very common in the meter. And then here's our friendly 57, which we already saw Luke use, because 57 years after this is the actual same text that Christ used, "Don't be deceived." Alright? So Luke is very much playing on the Matthew text. He's very well aware of the syllable counts per clause. And that's how you're supposed to do it. Whether it's in the Old Testament or in the New, you do your syllable counts per clause. Now, in the Old Testament, it's a little easier because somewhere, though, the copyist must have known this, because the verses kind of evenly seven at the end of the verses, if they're going to seven at all. You don't have to do it by clause, but in the Greek, you have to do it by clause. Sometimes, you know, I ran the clauses together. Well, not here. This is Matthew. Matthew, I had to do it by clause to see what was going on. But like here, okay, I got two clauses here in the Greek. And I just left them together. I knew that they totaled 28, so it didn't matter to me that I had two of them together. Okay? Sometimes you have to, sometimes you don't. But the point is that you're really supposed to do it by clause if you're going to be a purist about this. And doing it by clause, you end up seeing where the writer is intending to stress a period, because it'll seven. So there's a dateline, 19 years, you know, 49 years before Christ talks is when Herod was rebuilding the temple. 63 years from now, meaning the end of the year that he's talking. Because on the Jewish calendar, he's actually in the seventh month. On the Jewish civil calendar, he's actually in the seventh month. Passover is the seventh month of the civil year, which starts at the autumnal equinox. So that's why he's counting at 63 instead of 64. That's when the millennium was supposed to start, had there been no church. And then 84 is the number that Moses actually started in Psalm 90 to illustrate the divine decree that has been enacted but is not yet finished. In other words, it's been decreed but hasn't been carried out, or it's in the process of being carried out. And we know that that's what that means, because that's in Psalm 90 verse 4, day of the Lord is as a thousand years. That's got the decree connotation in the very text. And then Isaiah 53 splits this 84 into two 42s to bracket his own Isaiah 53. And you can go see the Isaiah 53 channel in Vimeo to see how he does that. Or you can look at the video just prior to when I started doing this Matthew versus Luke series, because I included it there. So these meters have specific meanings all of themselves. 126 is the number is when Isaiah dates his own text. Hi, I'm writing 126 years before the temple is going to fall, and when the temple falls in 586 BC, which is yet future when Isaiah 53 is written, it'll be 126 years shy of its own 490-year allotment. Again, that's punning, mirroring the same time. And you'll notice that's all still about the temple. Okay? Because the whole text, see, tu yeru. That's the temple. Christ is the temple depicts. Ha ha. Okay? You know, it's literature. It's supposed to be funny. It's supposed to be punny. It's supposed to be memorable. Just because it's divine and it's the truth doesn't mean it has to be boring. And of course, in English, it's all boring, but not in the Greek, not in the Hebrew either, really. So you see, and then the distance is 42. So Matthew well knows that Isaiah 53 splits the 84 here in the 42. So he's playing on that difference. He's expecting the reader to go, ha-ha, and remember it when he sees the difference between 84 and 126. Okay. And, again, then we come to 147, which is the sum of 70 and 77. But the difference here is only 21. 21 is the number of growth. That's when Jacob came out. You know, come into the land, coming out away from Haran. That's the signal of growth. He was 21 years when he had comes out. And he comes out with two families, so that's where the 42 is coming from. It's really cute. So all these meter numbers actually have doctrinal meanings that are established in the Bible, in the text. It's not something to actually invent. So what that ends up telling you is that as you're reading the text and you see the number, you're getting like a numeric commentary on the text, and that helps you know what the text is actually saying and what it's leading to. And of course, in the text itself, it's like, hi, a temple's going to go down. You're busy admiring the building, but here I'm the building depicts, and I'm telling you something, and you're not listening. Isn't that how it always goes? So they're using temple meter numbers that are in Isaiah 53 in order to kind of like bring that point trenchantly home. So what that tells you then, therefore, is that when you start to look at all these numbers that are listed, knowing that you're supposed to add 30 in order to get the AD, they're all related to Jerusalem, the temple, the Bible, diaspora, because that's what these numbers all signify. Okay, 28 is half of 56. You know, and 217 is Mary's actual meter in the Magnificat. It's also God's meter plus 14. Mary deducts 14. In God's reply to Daniel in Daniel 9:24-27. Now, a reader who was living at the time, familiar with syllable counting, would have recognized all these things I just said so quickly. It wouldn't be news to them. It's news to you and me because we weren't brought up with this. But if you grew up on your mother's knee like Mary did, or Daniel did, you would have learned all these stuff like you learned your ABCs. That's what we've lost in Scripture. Okay? This is what didn't get carried on and taught to us. So by the time you go through these numbers, it's like, oh, you already know what he's talking about. He's talking about Bible, he's talking about temple, he's talking about diaspora, he's talking about essentially salt going saltless. So how does the salt get itself back again? You know, because you got the Song of Moses, all history is based on the Jews. Well, then how does the salt get salty again? All history is based on Christianity now. Both. You know, two houses, two walls, Ephesians 2. So, where does the salt get salty again? Are there good periods? Yeah. That's what these orange numbers are supposed to signify. But I hope you're getting the sense, even if it's like this is all a blur to you, I hope you're getting the sense that, oh wow, this Matthew stuff, these meters really matter. And Luke really knows what they are, and he's playing to them. So why is he 70 where the Lord isn't? What does the 70 even mean? Well, my voice is going out again, so I'll cover that in the next increment.